Hey, it's Medium Jenny Lee back again with another raw book discussion. We're in session 20. So this is going to be video number 21. We've made it to session 20. And in volume one, there are 56 sessions. We're going to be here forever. And then there's a whole nother volume two. This is going to take a really long time. And you know what? I'm okay with that. Let's get started on today's. Okay, first question from Dawn for session 20, and they've made it to February 9th, 1981. To go back a little bit, what happened to the second density entities who were harvestable? The second density is able to repeat during third density a portion of its cycle. Okay. Next question. Were any of those who remain in second density harvested into third density in the past 75,000 years? It's been increasingly true. So more and more second density beings are being harvested into third density. And just to remind you that currently the second densities are, there's three types: animals, trees, and places. As weird as that sounds. Okay. Can you give me an example of a second density entity coming into the third in the recent past? And this got brought up earlier, but it's going to be talked about a little bit more. Perhaps the most common occurrence of second density graduation during third density cycle is the so-called pet, the animal which is exposed to the individualizing influences of the bond between animal and a third density entity, human. This individualization causes a sharp rise in the potential of the second density entity, so that upon the cessation of a physical complex, the mind-body complex does not return under the undifferentiated consciousness of that species, if you will. What type of entity do they become here? As a second density entity returns as third density for the beginning of this process of learning, the entity is equipped with the lowest, if you will, so-called these vibrational distortions, forms of a third density consciousness that is equipped with self-consciousness. This would be a human form then? Would it be beginning the understandings of third density? Is this correct? This is correct. How exciting! Your beloved pet just might become a human. Isn't that exciting? I think it's exciting. So, if you feel like you might have had an animal past life, it's very possible, because this is saying that animals, trees, and places can become third density. Now, the places, remember, was the least common, animals being the most common. I think that's really cool. Continuing on. I am aware of the physics of Dewey B. Larson, who states that all is motion or vibration. Am I correct in assuming that the basic vibration which makes up the physical world as we experience it changes, thus creating a different set of parameters, shall I say, in the short period of time between densities, allowing for a new type of vehicle? Am I correct? Correct. We'll talk about who this person is in a second. Let's finish the information about him first. Was Dewey Larson's physics correct? The physics of sound vibration complex Dewey is a correct system as far as it is able to go. There are those things which are not included in the system. But using the basic concepts of vibration and the study of vibrational distortions, we'll begin to understand that which we know of as gravity, and those things you consider as n dimensions. So people that continue studying along Dewey Larson's lines will discover, basically be able to figure out the secrets of gravity and things called n dimensions. So Dewey Larson lived from 1898 to 1960, I can't read my own handwriting. He was an engineer and author. Reciprocals, this is what he came up with. It's called the Reciprocal System of Physical Theory. And there's a book that he wrote called The Structure of the Physical Universe. And I didn't go too much more into him because, well, first of all, his Wikipedia page was like under the, it was like under the question of being deleted for some reason, which is kind of interesting. Like, why would they want to delete his whole YouTube, his whole Wikipedia page? But I found another website. It was like a science website that was talking about him. So then I had to look up what these n dimensions are, and even though I'm not a math person, so I can hardly understand what the hell they were talking about. But an n dimension are points of a constant form that go to a fixed point at the center of a sphere. So a spherical, it's like measuring the points, fixed points on the outside of a sphere to its center, is about as far as I could understand that craziness. So somehow that mixed with gravity, we can understand and get it all figured out. Whether, and I don't know if we have or not, and I don't think we figured out gravity, so probably not, but he was right. What he was figuring out was accurate. So I would be curious to know if there's people still trying to do research and learn and, you know, all the math that's involved to figure out what he started, or did it just get lost? If they're trying to delete his Wikipedia page, it ain't looking good. Was this entity, did he bring this material through in his incarnation for use primarily in the fourth dimension? Correct. So he's trying to teach us this stuff so that we could have it for the fourth density dimension. Okay, so yesterday's video discussion was talking about this analogy of electricity, so we can understand the negative and positive polarities of the consciousness. And I feel like Don explains it even better here. Okay, so it's my impression that it is in electricity. If you have no polarity in electricity, you have no electricity. You have no action. Therefore, am I assuming that in consciousness, without such polarity, there would be no action or experience? Correct. You may use the general term work or learning lessons, I would say. Then the concept of service to self or service to others is mandatory if we wish to have work, whether it be conscious work or mechanical. Newtonian concept in the physical, is this correct? This is correct with one addendum. The coil, as you may understand this term, is wound, its potential is ready. The thing that is missing without polarizing is the charge. So this is all interesting and very cryptic, but the way that I'm understanding it is, in electricity, you have to have a polarity or there's no electricity. So the same thing is true with consciousness. You have to have the positive, service to others, and you have to have the negative, service to self, or there's no experience. You can't learn any lessons if there's no differences to learn from. If there's no polarity, if there's no charge, if you will. But then Ra explains it in an analogy of a coil. A coil already has the potential to spring forward because it's wound tightly, but it's not going to work without a charge. And another definition of charge is when you're in a war, you know, a war fought over land is going to have to charge forward to have action. Not that I'm saying that we're fighting a war, sometimes it feels like it, but just to have the necessary experiences for learning, we have to have this polarity between positive and negative so that we can learn anything. That makes sense. As crappy as it is, that makes sense. Okay, next. Then the charge is provided by individualized consciousness, correct? The charge is provided by the individualized entity using the inpourings and instreamings of the energy by the choices of free will. So we're getting the instreaming energy through our choices that we make. Now here comes some real weird stuff. Get ready. Put your weird hat on. Okay, as soon as the third density started 75,000 years ago and we incarnated third density entities, what was the average human lifespan? The average lifespan was 900 years. So those of you who have studied the Bible, grew up with Christianity, you guys already know this information. And I'm curious to know also if it's in other religious texts other than the Bible or other beliefs in the world. But I remember Frost Giant telling me about, because he grew up as a Christian, about Methuselah living to be like 900 years old. So I went and looked it up. And in the book of Genesis, there's a long list of people that lived, you know, 600 to 900 and some years, with Methuselah dying at 969 as the oldest one. And it's like all the, like the grandfathered in people of the Bible, you know, like Noah's great grandfather and, or Noah's grandfather and like all, and Adam and like all these people lived to be 800, 900, 700, 600 years old. So that's pretty interesting that here it is again, stating that the people at the beginning lived to be 900 years old, and the Bible also says the people at the beginning lived to be 900 years old. How interesting. You know, all the religious stuff out there, as much as we get it wrong, there's little nuggets, grains of truth in all of them, you know? Okay. Did the average lifespan grow or shorten as we progress in the third density? Don, you know the answer to this question. There was a particular use for this lifespan in this density. And given the harmonious development of the learning and teachings, the lifespan of the physical complex would remain the same. However, your planetary sphere developed vibrations by the second major cycle, which shortened the lifespan dramatically. Damn humans. Okay. So after the 25,000 year cycle, how long was the lifespan? The average lifespan at the end of the first 25,000 years was 700 years. So we lost 200 years after the first 25,000 years, correct? The causes of this shortening, so what were the reasons? The causes of the shortening are always inharmonious relation, vibration between other selves. In the first cycle, this was not severe due to the dispersion of peoples. The growing feeling complex distortions towards separateness from other selves. So people were so spread out over the earth. There was not a lot of people, and they're so spread out that they just weren't learning enough stuff. So it caused the lifespans to shorten. Is the reason for the negative polarization, the shortening of the cycle, the influx of entities from Mars who are already polarized somewhat negatively? Incorrect. there was not a strong negative polarization due to this influx. The lessening of the lifespan was due primarily to the lack of the building up of positive orientation. When there's no progress, these conditions which grant progress are gradually lost. This is one of the difficulties of remaining unpolarized. The chances of progress become steadily less. So there just was not enough people interacting with each other. There wasn't enough different kinds of polarized people interacting with each other for anybody to learn anything, even though they're living 700 to 9, or at that point, 900 years. Next question. We have a mixture of entities, those who have graduated from second density on Earth to become third density, and then the group that was transferred here from Mars. Correct? Correct. You must remember that those transferred to the sphere were in the middle of the third density, so that this third density was an adaptation rather than a beginning. The people of Mars didn't make it to the end of their cycle. So who were in the third density at the time? Were Martian, and what percentage were harvested out of Earth's second density? So Dawn wants to know what percentage was the Martian people and what percentage was the Earth people. And this is very interesting. One half of the third density population were from Mars. One quarter were from Earth. And another quarter were from other places whose entities chose this planetary sphere for their third density work. So only at that particular time, only a quarter of the humans on Earth were actually beings that evolved from second density to third density on Earth. Half of them were incarnated from Mars, and another quarter of them were from other places. So it's largely mixed. Oh no, wait a minute. It was a largely mixed group of entities, but then Don asked, when they incarnated, did they mix? Did all three of the types mix together in societies or groups, or were they separated? It was largely unmixed, so they stuck to themselves. So it was a possibility of warlike attitudes between the groups, correct? Did this reduce the lifespan? They reduced the lifespan, yes. So the different groups kept to themselves. They didn't want to mix with each other. They had a warlike attitude with each other, and it reduced the lifespan even more. Can you tell me why 900 years is the optimum lifespan? This part, what is coming up explains so much to me about the human race. Just wait. The mind-body-spirit complex of the third density has perhaps 100 times as intense of a program of catalytic action from which to distill distortions and learn teaching than any of the other densities. So third density is 100 times more intensive than any other densities. Thus, the learned teaching are most confusing, as people are inundated by an ocean of experience. So the mind-body-spirit complex is inundated with a ton of experience. During the first 100 to 200 years, the mind-body-spirit complex is going through a process of spiritual childhood. I feel like I need to underline that part because it was so profound to me. It takes 150 to 200 years to get to the point where we can even learn spiritual lessons. The mind and body are not disciplined enough to lend clarity to spiritual influxes. Thus, the remaining time span is given to optimize the understanding which results from the experience itself. So the first 150 to 200 years of a normal third density being's life is just gathering the experience so they can get to the point where they can review and learn and understand it in a spiritual way. So what does that mean about us humans now? Then at present, it would seem that our lifespan's much too short for those who need third density lessons. Yes, Don. Yes, this is correct. Those entities which had in some way learned taught themselves the appropriate distortions for rapid growth can now work within the confines of the shorter lifespan. However, oh, this sentence, the greater preponderance of your entities find themselves in what may be considered a perpetual childhood. First of all, let's back up to the sentence before that. There are entities that have learned, taught themselves how to rapidly grow and work in the confines of the shortened lifespan. And the answer to that solution was to purposefully place themselves in trauma. The answer to the question of how can we quickly learn spiritual lessons was to purposefully select a traumatic event. I have been, oh man, this is like such a huge thing for me. I have been working since May of 2021 on my own physical, mental, spiritual healing, emotional healing from my own trauma. And as I was starting to unlock it all, I knew that the trauma that I had was placed there so that I could have a rapid succession, so that I could be able to do spiritual work at this particular point in my life. I know that. And I'm going to share something with you that I've only shared with maybe a couple other people. Because part of our learning, part of our ability to move up in density is to experience, understand, accept, and share. We learned that a couple days ago, right? So this is my own. I was really, really upset and pissed off that I had to choose, or I did choose consciously of my own accord, to go through a traumatic experience as a child. And I could not accept that I myself would have chosen that to go through. And I was really pissed off that that kind of thing happens to so many children. And why in the hell would we choose to do this? And there has to be another way. There has to be another way. Why is this the only thing? Why is this the only way that we can rapidly grow in our spirit, so we can become spiritual workers or have an awakening or whatever? I was so mad about it. This was like last summer, so this was like a year ago. And at the time, I was doing a lot of sitting in the power meditation, which I can explain that at another time. I don't want to make this video too long. And I had an entity. I knew it was a male entity. Come and tell me that this was the way, that was the way that it had to be, that children had to experience trauma in order to grow. And I got pissed. And I was like, no. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. I also felt that this entity was being deceptive and manipulative and trying to convince me that this was the only way. And I was at the point where I was like, no. No, I'm not gonna listen to you. This is not acceptable. you're not a good being. And I haven't shared this yet either. A few people know about this. One of my spirit guides is a Maya priest. And at that time I had just discovered him through these sitting and the power exercises. I had just discovered who he was and that he was one of my guides. And I didn't ask for any assistance to remove this entity from my presence, but my Maya priest, oh, it's 11:11, good Lord. Okay, my Maya priest came out of the ether with, okay, so he's got a black line of paint that goes across his eyes. He's got like a headdress on that has like feathers and stuff, but it's still on the back of his head. And he carries a stick that is like his priest, you know, scepter or whatever. I don't know what the right word is. But at the top of it, it has like shells and stuff that makes a lot of noise. He came running at this guy, shaking his stick with all the shells rattling all over it, and scared the guy away. And ever since then, my Maya priest guy is, he's my gatekeeper. He's my gatekeeper for when I do my spirit art or I practice trance. He's the one I ask to let through a spirit that he thinks is appropriate, because I know that he's going to protect me and he knows the difference between the good ones and the bad ones. Because that entity was. And I wonder if he wasn't. I wonder if the entity that was trying to tell me that there was no other way was one of these, like, Orion group service to self type of entities. And now that I know what that is, that's what feels right to me. He was trying to manipulate me into thinking that there was no other way. And I had, after that meditation, whenever I would do sitting in the power exercises, which I haven't done one in quite a while, I would always write down in my journal, like, what happened. And as I'm writing it all down, I got more and more and more and more angry. And I... because this is the way I am. I said, you wait until I get back there. We're not doing this anymore. I'm coming up with some other way. There has to be another way that people can experience spiritual things at a quicker rate than having a child go through some horrific trauma. And I still feel that way. There has to be another way. There has to be. I understand the polarities and the light and dark and the negative and the positive, and you can't have action if there's not polarity. I got it. But does it have to be so damaging for someone? I don't think it has to be. I really don't. So I'm still sticking to my guns there. When I get back there, we're fixing some shit. And I don't give a shit who the hell wants to tell me what. That's the way I feel. We are fixing some shit. I'm coming into the goddamn Confederation. I don't care what the hell. We're fixing this shit. Do you hear me? I'm coming. You wait. Give it about, how old am I? 40? I'll be 41 next month. Give it about another 40 some years. You wait. You guys just wait until I get back up there. We're fixing this. Okay, enough ranting and raving. But anyway... I got so wound up in my own story, I forgot about the next part. There's a whole nother part of this paragraph. See what happens? Two sentences and I got completely wound up. Okay. The other part of this paragraph that is extraordinarily important and that I have felt my whole life and I never could put it into words was this sentence. The greater preponderance of entities find themselves in what they consider, what may be considered a perpetual childhood. the majority of humans on this planet never, ever, in their measly little lifetimes, get to the place where they can experience, understand, accept, and share, and start having some sort of spiritual growth. And because I see it so much, so many people, where I'm just like, how can you not possibly understand what is happening to you? How can you not, it came up yesterday in the last video, how can you not possibly see the patterns of your life that you continue to repeat over and over again that cause you so much horrific pain and trauma and awful shit? How can you not see it? How can you not understand that it's something you're supposed to learn from and change? And so many people are that way. And now I understand. Now I get it. Because there's only so many people that have used this rapid growth technique to be able to work in the short lifespan. And that majority of other people either choose not to, don't know about it, haven't made it that far, or whatever, I don't even know. And it just made me feel like I understand humanity so much more. And I think I'll have a lot more, which I already have. I had already, you know, in my teens and 20s, it just made me angry and it made me not like people. It made me literally have a hatred for people. And in my 30s, that started to change. And now, you know, in my late 30s and now currently, I have so much more grace, acceptance, and forgiveness for people. And I feel like knowing this bit of information in those two sentences of this book will only help me have even more patience, grace, and forgiveness for others. Because they really just don't know. And they don't understand. Because they haven't got there yet. Maybe, just maybe, one person will watch these videos and something will click in them and make them see their own patterns and have their own spiritual awakening, their own personal journey towards starting to work towards the next density. Okay. Let's keep going. All right. I've completely worn myself out. I'm getting so wound up about this. Okay. Back in the first 25,000 year period, what type of aid did the Confederation give to the entities so that they could grow? Confederation members, which dwell in the inner plane of existence with the planetary complex of vibratory densities, worked with these entities. There was also aid of one of the Confederation, which worked with those of Mars in making the transition. For the most part, the participation was limited, as it was appropriate to allow the full travel of workings of the confusion mechanism to operate in order for the planetary entities to develop what they wished. Shall we say freedom within their own thinking? So there's very little interaction between the Confederation and humanity, other than transitioning people from Mars and, you know, like checking in with us and whatever. It is often the case that third density planetary cycle will take place in such a way that there's no outside need or other self in the form of information. Let's read this part over again. It is often the case The third density planet cycle will take place in such a way that there is no need for outside or other self aid in the form of information. Rather, the entities themselves are able to work themselves toward the appropriate polarizations and goals of third density learning and teaching. So most planets throughout the whole span of existence, when they get to third density, require a little help from the outside. Except for us, because we're special. We're real special. Okay, what was Don's next question? Okay. I make the assumption that if maximum efficiency had been achieved in the 25,000 year period, the entities would have polarized towards service to self or service to others, and this would have made them harvestable at the end of the 25,000 year period with one side or the other to the fourth density, in which case they would have to move to another planet because this one wouldn't be ready for fourth density for more than 50,000 years. Is that correct? Let us untangle your assumption because it's complex and in part correct. The original desire is that entities seek and become one. If entities can do this in a moment, they may go forward in a moment. And thus, were this to occur in a major cycle, indeed the third density planet would be vacated at the end of the cycle. So if it could happen in an instant where third density could move up to fourth density, it would. And if it happened before the end of the major cycle, then all the third density beings that became fourth density would have to move to the next place. They wouldn't be able to live on the third density planet. However, more toward the median or mean of the third density developments throughout the one infinite universe, that there be a small harvest after the first cycle, the remainder having significantly polarized, the second cycle having much larger harvest, and the remainder would be more specifically polarized, and the third cycle culminating the process and the harvest being completed. So most of the time, or the median, mean, so average, on average, the average number of planetary third density cycles, peoples, beings, are able to get through the whole entire third density within the 75,000 years. Then was the Confederation, so shall we say, watching to see and expecting at the harvest of the end of the 25,000 year period, in which a percentage would be harvestable to fourth density, and a fourth density positive and another towards negative. Correct. You may see our role in the first major cycle as that of the gardener. Knowing the season, is content to wait till the spring. And when the springtime does not occur, the seeds do not sprout, then it is the gardener who must work in the garden. So nobody was able to go up to the fourth density after the 25,000 years. No seeds sprouted, so the Confederation felt like they needed to come and work a little bit to get the seeds sprouting. So there was neither harvestable entities toward positive or negative at the end of the 25,000 years. Correct. We've gone over this, Don. To whom may call the Orion group made one attempt to offer information to a third density, to those of third density during the cycle, but it did not fall upon the ears of any who were concerned with this to follow this path to polarity. So remember, the Orion group attempted to reach out, but nobody got it. What technique did they use? Two kinds: telepathy, the arrangement of certain stones in order to suggest strong influence of power, this being those statues of rock formations in your Pacific areas and in Central American regions. The arrangement of stones. This is going to be interesting. Okay. Are you speaking of the stone heads of Easter Island? Correct. So I assume the majority of people know what the Easter Island heads are, which this is really funny, actually, because this is being this is being shared in 1981, remember? Well, in 1987, so 6 years later, archaeologists discovered that they're not just heads, that they're actually full-bodied sculptures of people. And if you don't know what they look like, you should definitely go look at them. So, how would such stone heads, now we know sculptures, influence the people to take the path of service to self? Picture, if you will, the entities living in such a way that their mind-body-spirit complexes are at what seems to be the mercy of forces which they cannot control. Yes. Given a charged entity, such a statue or rock formation charged with nothing but power, it is possible for the free will of those viewing this particular structure or formation to ascribe to this power, power over those things which cannot be controlled. This has the potential for the further distortion to power over other selves. So by creating these massive sculptures that are full of power, the Orion group was hoping that by human seeing them, that it would cause them to want to control things that were beyond their control, and in turn control other people. How were they constructed? Through thought. After a scanning of the deep mind, the trunk of the mind tree, looking at the images most likely to cause the experience of awe in the viewer. So they created gigantic people with thought. Okay. We still don't understand that, but yeah. Remember, it's communicating with the intelligent infinity within the stone itself and asking it to form itself into a specific way. Is the way they explained it during the pyramid conversation. Did Orion entities do this themselves? Do they land here? Or do they do it from mental planes? Or do they use one of the incarnate entities to construct these by thought? So, do they come here? Do they do it from where they were? Or did they use a human? Nearly all these structures and formations were constructed at a distance by thought, so wherever they actually were. Few of them were in later times imitation of the original constructs by entities of the earth plane. So the original oldest ones are supposedly created by the Orion group. They made them through thought from a distance. But then humans created them in imitation later on. What a density Orion entity did the creation of these heads? Fourth density, density of love or understanding, was the density of a particular entity who offered this possibility to those of the first major cycle. You use the same nomenclature for fourth density negative as you do positive. Both are called the dimension of love and understanding, correct? Love and understanding, whether it be self or self towards other self, is one. So it's hard for people of service to others to understand that service to self people are still experiencing love and understanding, but that's what they're doing. Okay. What's the approximate date of the construction of these heads? 60,000 years ago. Okay, I looked up the carbon dating of the oldest Easter Island sculptures. And they date to 700 to 850 CE. That is not 60,000 years ago. So either Ra is not giving us the correct information, or our carbon dating is a bunch of crap. Both are possible. Both are possible. What are the structures in South America? In this location were fashioned some characteristic statues, some formations of what you call rock, and formations involving rock and earth. Were the lines at Nazca included in this? Correct. So if you don't know what the Nazca lines are, please look it up. They are amazing, carved into the ground figures of animals and different things, but you can only see them from above at a high altitude. And that's what Don says. Since they can only be seen from an altitude, what benefit did this have? The formations were of benefit because charged with energy and power, just like the Easter Island sculptures. I'm confused. These lines at Nazca are hardly understandable for someone walking on the surface, but if you go up to a high altitude, you can see the patterns. How to benefit people walking on the surface? At the remove of the amount of space-time, which is now your present, it is difficult to perceive that 60,000 years ago, the Earth was formed in such a way to be visibly arranged in powerful structural designs from a vantage point of distant hills. So you're saying there's hills that would allow people to see them from above. The entire smoothness as you see this area now was built up in many places and hills. The time-space continuum was preceded by with wind and weather. It caused it to erode at a great extent. Both the somewhat formidable structures of Earth design at the time and the nature of the surrounding countryside. Then these lines are just faint traces of what used to be there. Correct. Okay. So Ra is saying that the Nazca lines are also from 60,000 years ago. Let's look up when we think that they were made. I wonder if they can even carbon date that because they're in the ground. Lines, dates. Okay, the Nazca lines are a group of geoglyphs made in the soil of the Nazca Desert in southern Peru between 500 BCE and 500 CE. That's a big time difference. All right. Okay. So they're massively huge depictions of different things. Birds, I think there's a monkey, there's a spider, etc. And they're absolutely massive, and they're on the grounds of the desert floor, and they're still there. I don't know what they use to date the Nazca lines. I know they used carbon dating to date the Easter Island sculptures. I don't know how they can assume what the dates of the Nazca lines are. Probably based on what they know of the people that lived there over the history of time. And we know that the time frame of humans on the Americas keeps getting older and older and older as they find more and more artifacts and skeletons and things. So I could say that the Nazca lines, we probably have no idea. But if the Easter Island sculptures were carbon dated, and that does not line up with what Ra says, then I don't know. Supposedly the pyramids are much older. The Great Pyramid and the Sphinx are way older than archaeologists say they are too, so. That's in the Fingerprints of the Gods book from Graham Hancock, if you're interested. That book keeps coming up over and over again in these discussions. Anyway, let's review what we did in this session. We talked a lot about continuing about the human evolution on Earth. Dewey Larson was brought up about the physics, that what the man had discovered was correct. The analogy of electricity for positive and negative consciousness, the lifespans of humans over the earliest times, where the different entities came from, what caused the lifespans to shorten, this whole rapid growth versus perpetual childhood was insane. And then we learned about some information about the Easter Island sculptures and the Nazca lines. Once again, another jam-packed session discussion. So tell me what you guys think. Questions, comments, concerns, personal experiences, etc. Join in on the discussion. We'd love to have you join with what you think is what. This is not a one-sided conversation. Anyway, if you like the video, give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. There's a lot of videos before this one, and clearly there's going to be a ton of videos afterwards. So if you're enjoying these, keep watching them. And I will see you for the next video later. Bye.